Hello, everybody. I'm Alejandro Pino Iglesias, working for Igalia. I'm going to present here the overview of the development of the Vulkan driver for the Raspberry Pi 4. So, starting with the contents of the presentations, I'm going to start with the development story, how this evolved during this year, and then I'm going to explain the current state of the driver, followed by explaining some of the challenges that we have when we were doing the implementation, and I will end the presentation with the future plans for the driver and how to contribute for the driver for anyone that is interested in that. So the development story. So we can say that we work on the driver for 1 year, so it is basically a 1 year summary of the development of the driver. The name of this driver, the code name, is B3DB. That is basically the same name that for the OpenGL driver, with a P at the end for Vulkan. The development started in a public fork of Mesa, and it reused a lot of the utilities and code that is available on Mesa. So, like for example, we leverage a lot from the Windows system that is abstracted on Mesa and is reused by all the Vulkan drivers. From the OpenGL driver, we reuse mostly all of the B3D NIR compiler. Obviously, we needed to make some changes, but we mostly use the compiler that is used by the OpenGL driver. And we use the same kernel interface as B3D. The idea that we have when we created this project is that trying to focus on just one thing at one moment. So we started with the idea of not touching the kernel interface even if we needed that, but in the end we were lucky enough that we needed to touch the kernel interface for that. Obviously we could do that and improve some things, but at this moment we got everything working without doing that. So trying to explain the evolution of the driver development by checkpoints. The driver, we started to work on this driver on November 2019, but at the beginning was mostly analysis, trying to understand the minimum that we needed to do in order to start the driver. So in November we were doing this analysis, and on December we started to do some development, and by January we were able to get the triangle demo, the basic, the really famous triangle with colors working with our early driver. By May, we got some of Sasha William demos running. Sasha William demos are really popular Vulkan demos. They are slightly more than just one triangle and just one test, so nice looking. By June, we moved development to open repositories. The thing is that at the beginning, when we needed to do everything and we were doing change, redoing and abstracting and redoing again our driver, we were working on a private repository. The thing is that we were at the beginning we were working those two people, Iago Torrado and myself. And by June we think that things were stable enough to open the development to open repository, so anyone interested could take a look. We even got some book issues, some repositories, some pull reports, and some patches at that moment. So it was a good thing. By July, we got all the Quake ports to Vulkan working. So that was basically the first real application doing something more than just showing some images working. And by August, we got the Vulkan 1.0 implementation without extra features. At that point, we still had some bugs and some tests that were not working, but the implementation of all the features needed for Vulkan 1.0 was done by that point. Now that we have all the features done and that the driver was still was slightly more mature, by October we moved development to Mesa upstream. So that means that it got integrated with Mesa. It was the changes on other parts of the driver when Mesa, the Mesa CI was wrong, was also testing that we got everything working. Also, the use tracker and was the Mesa stream. So basically, we got the drive integrated with the Mesa community, with Mesa stream. By November, because I think one of the issues that we had is that we needed to, it was complex for us to find more applications using Vulkan that we could test on the Raspberry. So we worked on getting Think working. Think is a framework or library that expose the OpenGL functionality, but internally use Vulkan. So we improved the interoperability with it, so we could test OpenGL applications, but we could be able to use our Vulkan driver with OpenGL applications. By November, we got all our test pieces, and we sent the driver to be conformant to the Kronos. So that means that right now, this driver is officially Vulkan 1.0 conformant. It's even on the Kronos page about the list of drivers that fulfills the Vulkan 1.0 API. And by December, we tested this driver on 64-bit because we started with the default Raspberry operating system, Raspbian, 32-bit. But now we have available the 64-bit, and we tested that. And we started to work on improving the performance of the driver. So going back to the beginning of the project, the initial early milestone was getting to render something on the hardware. We used a lot Vulkan CTS to improve iteratively the features of the driver. The thing is that with CTS, you usually need more than several things working. Like for example, when you are, by the way, Vulkan CTS is the main Kronos test suite. That is the one that is used to verify that your driver is conformant with the spec. So, although our objective was using Vulkan CTS to create a driver, at the beginning we need to write our custom tests, because the thing is that for those tests usually you need more than one more than just one thing. Like for example, if you render something and you want to verify that you are rendering something correctly, then you need to copy things back and compare. But you don't, but at the beginning of the development you didn't have the copy back stuff. In any case, as our main objective, after we got all those basic tests working, was guide the development of the driver using CTS. So, for example, we had a subset of the CTS for regression testing, because the thing is that CTS is really complete and really detailed, so they have thousands of tests. So if we wanted to check if we were introducing any regression, waiting for several hours was not really practical. So we wrote our own subset you can see that as a smoke testing subset. So right now we have around 10,000 tests, but the thing is that we started with some tests as we were adding more features to the driver, we were adding more tests to this subset. With those 10,000 tests, we are able to run them in around 10-15 minutes. That is okay. I mean, you make a change, you are working on a feature, you verify that it's everything working, 10 minutes, okay, then you can push to the repository. The thing is that obviously, as we are only running app subset, we want to verify that everything is working. So every week at the beginning, we were doing full CTS runs, all the tests, and as I said, that needed some hours. In fact, it requires more time as when you have some tests that were failing. It requires more time than when all tests were passing. So at the beginning of the project, we doing a full run could be like 7 hours, 10 hours, but now it's around 4 hours. Another thing that we did since the beginning is assert everywhere. The thing is that, for example, if we were working on a feature, it was not complete because, like for example, if we were working on rendering, but we were not supporting yet multi-sample, we added an assert if the number of samples were greater than one. Why? The thing is that we wanted to avoid crashes after at some point without knowing why they were crashing. If just adding a cert fixed that problem. And also we tried to provide feedback and we were publishing a blog post regularly. Okay, so about the current state of the driver. As I mentioned before, right now we have Vulkan 1.0, all the mandatory features complete. We also have some optional features implemented. The thing is that if we see that we're easy to add, we added them, mostly because they were already supported by the OpenGL driver. But in any case, we have several optional features and extensions still missing. On November, we got 1.0 conformance passing. So, as I mentioned before, the driver is conformant with Vulkan 1.0. That means that for the CTS test, for the test suite, the official test suite, we are right now passing more than 100,000 tests, but we still have 600,000 skipped. And in any case, we are still doing regular full runs to ensure that we are still compliant with Kronos. And as I mentioned before, the Vulkan ports for the Quake games are working. As Open Arena, that is a game based on the port of the Vulkan Quake 3. The community also was able to run a PSP emulator using our driver and got some games working. And as I mentioned before, we also have the Vulkan driver working with Thing. That means that, for example, the OpenGL, sorry, that means that, for example, the Quake 3, we are able to run using DTR driver, the Vulkan driver, and we also are able to run it through Thing as an OpenGL driver, but internally use Vulkan. For what it's worth, for the case of the Quake 3 game, the Vulkan renderer has a better performance than the OpenGL renderer. We also got most of the Sasha William demos working. When I say most, I mean all the demos that doesn't require some extensions, like for example ray tracing, we are all getting all of them working. And as I mentioned before, although the Quake 3, the port of Vulkan Quake 3 is faster than the OpenGL renderer, we didn't make too much work, performance work yet, mostly on the Quake games. But the performance work that we did there was basically because at the beginning, for example, the first one that we tested was the Quake 2 port, and it was not working at all. When we got it working, it was like five frames per second. So there was clearly performance things that we should do differently. And this is the only work that we do. Right now, for example, the Quake 2, I think that it runs a property at 80-70 frames per second. But the performance work that we did was basic for the really obvious things, so we still it is still pending to make some detailed performance work for the Quake Day games and for any other applications that we find. About performance, we are aware that there are some slow parts in the drivers. Like for example, when we are doing transfer operations between buffers, between images, etc., we know that we are in some cases we are not going for the faster paths, and that we know that the TF unit, that is a test unit, that could be used more. We made some work on that, but there is still room for improvement. So some implementation challenges that we found during this year. One of the things that we can expect from the driver is that everything is to be executed from the GPU, but for our case, it's not possible in some cases. So in those cases, we need to use the CPU. That means that it makes the implementation some there are some friction on the implementations, and it also means that you need to do some extra coordination. In this case, extra coordination means do some flashes and some waits. This is also some issue about the linear display and the Raspberry Pi, because the V3D, the hardware cannot sample from linear image. So that means that for now we don't support sampling on XWeb chains. The thing is that it would be possible to make that working when we are running inside a compositor. But we found, well, we found, we think that it would be complex to expose that, because first of all, from the point of view of developer using our driver, it would be strange that this feature is not available on full screen, but it's available on window when you are on window mode. So for now, we are not doing that. We are not supporting something on XWeb chains. We could revisit this on the future. We also, as I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, we are reusing the abstraction for the Windows system, but we found that for our case is not optimal, because the optimal path requires PCIe GPU and PCIe BusInfo, but for the Raspberry we don't have a PCIe device, so we can't use that. So right now we have a merge request with some changes proposed, and the discussion is ongoing. So we hope that we will be able to improve this soon this year. So about the future plans, in the short term, we need more real-world testing. The thing is that I mentioned several times the Quake ports. The thing is that right now, those are the more complex applications that we tested the driver on. I mean, right now we have tested our driver with the CTS test, but the CTS test, the test suite from Kronos, are mostly about regression checking, about verifying that specific features are working, but are really focused on the features which are not real applications. We also tested on some small demos that we have in-house. And then we have these Quake ports. We also have some people in the community that tested with the PSP emulator, etc. But we need more real-world testing, especially to verify that the driver is covering all the corner cases needed. For the short, medium term, as I mentioned before, we could explore using better the TF unit to improve the transfer operations. We are working on improving the Windows system platform support. We also have on the to-do list the input attachment. Input attachment is a feature that it was is specific to Vulkan. That is basically that when you are working on an application that have several passes to create the final image. On some specific cases, you can just include the output of a previous pass as an input of the current pass. In theory, for a tile architecture like the Raspberry Pi, that would be an improvement over not using input and attachment, because you could just access directly to the tile as we are rendering. But right now our implementation is not doing that. It's just basically treating it as a texture. So there is a room for improvement there. There are also several, as I mentioned before, right now we have 1.0 plus some optional features, but obviously we could start to work on other optional features and extensions. Probably we should focus first on features and extensions that will are core for 1.1. But we also have some feedback from the community. We have some issues and some bad reports about missing extensions that are needed for specific applications. And finally, for the short medium term, and something that I mentioned before, we also need to assess the driver performance and trying to find ways to improve it, because the driver is the focus. The initial focus of the driver was to getting the features done for 1.0, but obviously there are some ways to improve performance. But this is related with real world testing. We need more applications to test this. Unfortunately for Vulkan, there is not a lot of benchmarks for Linux. So it would be also good to try to find any benchmark that we could use for this performance work. On the long term, we have in mind 1.1. I have a question mark there, because although we have this in mind, we don't have a clear deadline for that. We don't have a clear path for it. So initially, we are only going to start to work on optional features that will be part that are already part of core 1.1. The other thing that we have on our list is to improve the code reuse with the OpenGL driver. The thing is that one of the objectives of when we started to work with the Vulkan driver was not affecting the GL driver. The thing is that although some of the things are similar, we were modifying them for the Vulkan driver. But we didn't want to do some early refactoring, because we didn't want to do well refactoring now and then realize that, okay, but now this Vulkan feature needs other things, we need to refactor again and again. So now that we have the Vulkan driver done, we know everything that we need. There are some things that are really similar to the Vulkan driver or OpenGL driver that probably we could reuse and refactor, so we don't have the same thing duplicated. We also probably could port some features to the OpenGL drivers. The thing is that for the OpenGL driver, we support 3.3.1. And some of the features are optional for 3.1, but are mandatory for Vulkan 1.0. So there are some features that we implemented first for the Vulkan driver, like, for example, robust buffer access or sample write shading. And those, it would be nice to port those features to OpenGL, to the OpenGL's driver. So about how to contribute. Obviously, we are only two people, so we welcome any contribution from the community. So we are trying to create a stable context to enable external contributions. Some people mentioning that the hardware specifications are not available for the general public, but for example, we already have an OpenGL driver that somehow serve as the documentation for the hardware. Among other things, for example, it includes the tables for all the operations that the driver allows. Also in our code, we have a lot of fixes for things that could be improved. Like, for example, it seems that we think that it could be done in a different way to get a performance, or for example, if there are an optional feature, we add a fix mix, and we know where that optional feature should be implemented. We also have a fix mix here. If you want to do that feature, do that here. So for example, if anyone wants to contribute, you just need to start to look for all the fix mix, list them, and say, okay, I can work on this, or I can work on other things. As I mentioned before, there are several optional features pending. In fact, for example, I remember a bug report about someone asking for a feature and asking, okay, if I want to contribute to this, what I need to do? We made a, okay, if you want to do this, I think that what you should do is this, this, and this. That was somewhat complex, but I think that there are other optional features that could be more reasonable for a newcomer. And as I mentioned several times, we also need more testing and performance feedback. For example, as I mentioned before, the community got the PSP emulator working, and that was really nice. And they also provided some feedback about that testing. We also have some people that are testing this with a Dreamcast emulator and got it working. So this kind of testing with more applications, and it doesn't need to be emulators. Any Vulkan applications, it would be nice to get some testing from anyone and some performance feedback, and also pull reports. So for anyone that wants to contribute and provide feedback, there is a video core channel at Freenode for ORC. There is also the MesaDev mailing list, and for anyone that wants to create a bug report on GitLab, they are called issues. They can call GitLab issues or make requests if they were able to provide some patches. I want to end this presentation with a special thanks. We want to thank the Mesa community, because I said before, we are using a lot of data server on Mesa. We are using NIR, we are using reusing the SPIRB translator, the Windows System Integration Bits, etc. We also want to thank the system Mesa Vulkan drivers, because we obviously, for all the hardware, things need to be done differently, but we got a lot of inspiration from the Vulkan drivers. That includes the Intel Anvil, or FreeRhino, Turnip, and Radby. And finally, we want to really thank Eric Anholt. Eric Anholt was the maintainer of OpenGL driver. He wrote it. He knows a lot. He knew and knows a lot of the specific hardware. He replied, and he reviewed a lot of our questions, and he reviewed a lot of our patches. So we want to thank him. And finally, we also want to thank Dave Emmett, that was a contact from Broadcom. That is the one that is providing the hardware, because he also replied a lot of questions related with the hardware and how it works. So that's all. So if you have any question, and thank you very much for being here.